Hello and welcome to Byju's IAS. Let's take up the analysis of today's The Hindu newspaper by looking at an article from the front page of the Delhi edition. In this special article, Suhasini Heather writes about the close personal connection between former Indian President Pranab Mukherjee and the Sheikh Mujibur Rahman family of Bangladesh. Sheikh Mujibur Rahman is considered as the founding father of Bangladesh, and his daughter Sheikh Hasina is currently the Prime Minister of Bangladesh. This article highlights the close connections between the Indian government and several Indian leaders such as Indira Gandhi, Pranab Mukherjee, etc. with the Sheikh Mujibur Rahman family and the role that they played in the liberation of Bangladesh war. So it is in this context we need to have a detailed discussion on India's role in the liberation of Bangladesh war. See, before Bangladesh became independent in 1971, it was a part of the Pakistani state and was known as East Pakistan. Because after the Pakistani dominion was granted independence by the British, it was set up into two wings, that is West Pakistan and East Pakistan. These two wings of Pakistan were culturally, politically and economically very different. And these differences were underlined by the fact that East Pakistan was dominated by the Bengalis, whereas West Pakistan was dominated by the Punjabi Urdu speaking elite. Post 1947, West Pakistan became politically very dominant, and this led the Bengalis of East Pakistan to believe that they were being oppressed and discriminated against by the Punjabi Urdu speaking elite of West Pakistan. This sense of discrimination and oppression that was held by the Bengalis of East Pakistan encompassed all domains, including political, economic, and cultural. Politically, the military dictators of West Pakistan, such as Ayub Khan, Yahya Khan, etc., and the political parties of West Pakistan, such as the Pakistan People's Party, they always dominated over the political parties of East Pakistan, such as the Awami League, which was headed by Sheikh Mujibur Rahman. Even economically, West Pakistan and East Pakistan were completely different. Economic development in West Pakistan was largely urban-centric, whereas East Pakistan was still an agrarian economy. Upon this, the people of East Pakistan always felt that they were being economically exploited by the elite in West Pakistan. But the biggest differences amongst all were the cultural differences. In East Pakistan, the Bengalis were very proud of their culture, their language, and the region was seen to be more progressive and secular. Whereas West Pakistan was dominated by Urdu speakers, and it was slowly turning towards radical Islam as a result of the policies that were being adopted by the West Pakistani military dictators and West Pakistani politicians. The discrimination of East Pakistan at the hands of West Pakistan becomes very clear if you look at how Urdu was designated as the national language of Pakistan, whereas the same treatment was not given to the Bengali language and it was sidelined. So essentially, between the 1950s and 1970s, East Pakistan, that is the Bengalis of East Pakistan, they constantly felt discriminated and oppressed by the elite of West Pakistan. So this discrimination and oppression gave birth to a strong political resistance movement in East Pakistan that was built on the foundation of Bengali language and Bengali culture. And this movement was being championed by the Awami League. Even as the differences between West Pakistan and East Pakistan were increasing, the Awami League, led by Sheikh Mujibur Rahman, won a crucial national election in 1970. But this election result was not accepted by the political elite of West Pakistan. And West Pakistani politicians, such as Zulfikar Ali Bhutto, they refused to share power with Sheikh Mujibur Rahman, who had conclusively won a mandate in the 1970 elections. So this refusal of West Pakistan to share power with the Awami League and Sheikh Mujibur Rahman made it very clear for the people of East Pakistan that their future would never be secure as long as they were a part of the Pakistani state. So as a result, between 1970 and 1971, a Bengali resistance movement started to grow under the leadership of Sheikh Mujibur Rahman, and this quickly turned into a nationalist movement which was seeking independence from Pakistan. So as the Bengali resistance started to grow with the participation of intellectuals, students, professors and lawyers, the Pakistani army under dictator Yahya Khan decided to target the resistance movement and the protests by deploying force against civilians and protesters. On the 25th of March 1971, the Pakistani army launched the controversial Operation Searchlight, under which the Pakistani army started carrying out targeted killings and assassinations of the protesters. So this use of force with the Pakistani army under Operation Searchlight would eventually turn into a genocide where innocent civilians, including women and children, would be ruthlessly targeted by the Pakistani army. And according to reports, anywhere between 3 lakh to 3 million Bengalis were killed under Operation Searchlight. According to reports of the Indian government and Western governments, the Pakistani army ruthlessly targeted the protesters by shooting them down and by torturing those who were captured. And there are even reports of numerous rapes against women and children. And even entire Bengali inhabited areas were set on fire. So this massive use of violence by the Pakistani army against the Bengali resistance fighters was nothing short of a genocide, and this turned into a massive refugee crisis in the region. As a result of this violence, millions of Bengalis fled across the border into India and they sought refuge in the neighboring states of India. States such as West Bengal, Assam, etc., they started receiving a huge influx of Bengali refugees, and India was left to deal with this massive humanitarian crisis as a result of Pakistan's misbehavior. As the crisis unfolded, India decided to open up its borders and accepted the refugees and accommodated them in refugee camps that had been set up along the border areas. But eventually, India also started to feel the financial strain of accepting around 10 million refugees. Because during this point, India itself was struggling with severe economic challenges. Initially, India took in the refugees largely on humanitarian grounds, and also because of the close cultural and familial connections between Indians and Bengalis of East Pakistan. But as the crisis escalated, the Indira Gandhi government decided that India could no longer stay neutral. And then Prime Minister Indira Gandhi felt that India had a moral responsibility to act and protect the Bengalis in East Pakistan. And she also felt that this was a strategic opportunity through which India could exploit the divide in Pakistan in order to get back at Pakistan for its constant interference in India's internal affairs. So a combination of these factors motivated the Indira Gandhi government to get India directly involved in the liberation of Bangladesh war efforts. Most of us would be aware that the liberation of Bangladesh war eventually turned into an India-Pakistan war in December 1971. This was the overt phase of the war. But actually, 9 months before the overt war began, India had already launched a covert war against Pakistan even as the refugee crisis was escalating in March 1971. Even though the Indian government doesn't acknowledge this covert involvement, there is sufficient evidence available to indicate that the then Indira Gandhi government had authorized India's External Intelligence Agency, RAW, or the Research and Analysis Wing, to wage a covert war against Pakistan by sponsoring the Mukti Bahini rebel group. Mukti Bahini was basically a guerrilla force that was offering resistance against the atrocities of the Pakistani army, and reportedly India's RAW started supporting this outfit. This outfit largely comprised of Bengali refugees, and the RAW, along with its special frontier force, reportedly set up a number of training camps along the India-Pakistan border, that is along the East Pakistan border. And this is how India enabled the training of the Mukti Bahini fighters by providing them the required funds, weapons, etc. So between March and December 1971, the Mukti Bahini fighters who were supported by RAW, they would infiltrate back into East Pakistan and target the Pakistani army. And this would become the armed resistance of the Bangladeshi nationalist movement. Eventually, the Pakistani army and its ISI would become aware of Indian involvement, and in December 1971, it launched preemptive attacks against India, which would mark the beginning of the overt phase of the war between India and Pakistan. So in the first 2 weeks of December 1971, this overt war turned into a full-fledged war between India-Pakistan, involving the armies, the navies, and the air force. The Indian forces, which were well prepared for the conflict, unleashed a simultaneous assault on East Pakistan and as well as on West Pakistan. And this ensured a crushing defeat for Pakistan. And on the 16th of December 1971, the Pakistani army in East Pakistan officially surrendered to India. And this brought the liberation of Bangladesh war to an end with the establishment of Bangladesh as an independent country. This was a massive diplomatic and military victory for India because at the end of the conflict, Pakistan not only officially surrendered to India by signing the instrument of surrender, but India also held around 95,000 POWs or prisoners of war. Eventually, to formalize the transition of East Pakistan into Bangladesh and give it official recognition by Pakistan, the Shimla Agreement was signed between India and Pakistan. The Shimla Agreement of 1972 is a historic agreement which continues to remain relevant even to this day. Because under the Shimla Agreement, Pakistan finally recognized Bangladesh as an independent country. And this agreement also formalized the ceasefire between India and Pakistan in Kashmir into the line of control, or the LOC. Under this agreement, Pakistan agreed to stop interfering in India's internal affairs and resolve any disputes with India through negotiations, including the Kashmir dispute. Under the Shimla Agreement, both India and Pakistan have committed to not encourage any third-party mediation as far as the India-Pakistan disputes are concerned. These provisions of the Shimla Agreement is what makes the agreement relevant even to this day, because even today India brings up Pakistan's commitments under the Shimla Agreement, which it has conveniently violated over the years. Pakistan has not only failed to take up negotiations to resolve disputes with India, but it has also actively sponsored militancy, insurgency and terrorism. Pakistan has even tried to encourage third-party involvement in the resolution of the Kashmir dispute, which has always been rejected by India by citing the commitments of the Shimla Agreement. But nevertheless, 1971 was a defining moment for India's foreign policy because it had successfully provided diplomatic, military and covert assistance in the liberation efforts of a country and in its establishment as an independent country. The 1971 war was not just a regional conflict that was limited to India and Pakistan, but it also had global dimensions because this was the era of the Cold War and the United States and the Soviet Union were locked in a proxy war against each other in countries around the world. So this Cold War rivalry between the US and the Soviet Union would also play out in the 1971 conflict between India and Pakistan. Because see, by this time, China had already become a close ally of Pakistan because both the countries had fought conflicts with India in 1961 and in 65 and 47 respectively. During this period, Pakistan had become a close ally of the United States as well because for President Richard Nixon and his National Security Advisor Henry Kissinger, Pakistan had emerged as a close ally of the US, which was helping the US re-establish diplomatic ties with China. So when Indian assistance was threatening the integrity of Pakistan, the United States openly threatened India with consequences. It is also said that President Nixon and Henry Kissinger, they shared a personal hatred towards India and as well as towards Prime Minister Indira Gandhi. These factors pushed the United States to openly take the side of Pakistan in the 1971 war, and it is widely reported that the United States threatened India by dispatching its 7th Naval Fleet consisting of an aircraft carrier battle group into the Indian Ocean in order to put diplomatic and military pressure on India so that the Indira Gandhi government could be forced to stop providing assistance and support to the liberation of Bangladesh efforts. See, until 1970, India had firmly remained committed to the non-aligned movement, but the developments of 1971, wherein Pakistan, China and US were forming an axis, pushed India and the Indira Gandhi government to abandon the non-aligned principle and seek assistance from the Soviet Union. In a landmark development, India and the Soviet Union signed the 1971 Treaty of Peace and Friendship, and this is said to be a diplomatic masterstroke by Indira Gandhi. Because under the terms of this agreement, the Soviet Union promised to come to India's assistance if the United States threatened India with military consequences. Reportedly, the Soviet Union had even deployed its navy, including warships and submarines, into the Indian Ocean to counter the American naval deployment. Finally, it was this assistance given by the Soviet Union to India which deterred the Americans, and it finally prevented the United States from directly intervening in the India-Pakistan conflict. Throughout this period, the Indian government and Indian leaders maintained very close connections with the Awami League and the Sheikh Mujibur Rahman family. It is this close connection of trust and friendship that has been highlighted in this article. Later, after Bangladesh became independent, the Bangladeshi government has honored Indian leaders, Indian officials and Indian officers who were involved in the liberation efforts. And later in 1975, when Sheikh Mujibur Rahman and his family members were assassinated by few members of the Bangladeshi army, it was India which protected his daughter Sheikh Hasina, who later went back to Bangladesh to lead the Awami League, and she has successfully helped the Awami League win multiple elections, and she continues to serve Bangladesh as its Prime Minister. Now let's take up another article from page number 1 that evaluates a research paper that has been published by a few economists of the International Food Policy Research Institute. This latest paper has been published in the popular journal Food Policy. This research paper highlights the extent of hunger and undernutrition in India, and it helps us understand the affordability of food for Indians. See, in this year's economic survey, the government introduced a concept known as Thalinomics. Under this concept, the government tried to highlight the country's economic progress by illustrating how food has become increasingly affordable for most of the Indians. Under this concept of Thalinomics, the economic survey made use of the average cost of essential meals and evaluated whether this was affordable based on the earnings of industrial workers. Through this study under the concept of Thalinomics, the economic survey painted a very rosy picture with regard to India's economic progress and affordability of food. But however, the latest study published by the International Food Policy Research Institute paints a completely different picture. This study has shown that nearly 3 out of 4 Indians cannot afford a nutritious diet. The National Institute of Nutrition says that a nutritious diet comprises of not just cereals and pulses, but it also comprises of dairy food items, fruits, dark green leafy vegetables, etc. And the study conducted by the International Food Policy Research Institute shows that these essential food items, as prescribed by the National Institute of Nutrition, are not affordable for most of the people in the country. This study makes use of the wages of unskilled workers, unlike the wages of industrial workers, which was used by the government in its economic survey. Because in India, a majority of the workers are unskilled workers. And for the sake of comparison and analysis, the study makes use of market prices of food items, and it also relies upon data provided by the National Sample Survey. This study has shown that even if Indians spend their entire income on food, then still around 63.3% of the rural population in the country cannot afford nutritious food items. This roughly amounts to around 52 crore Indians, that is roughly 2 out of every 3 Indian. But obviously, in reality, no family spends their entire income on food. So realistically, if they spend 1/3 of their income on food, then the extent of hunger and undernutrition goes up significantly. And the study shows that in this context, nearly 76% of India's rural population won't be able to afford a nutritious diet. So essentially, this research paper supplements the findings of the Global Hunger Index, which we discussed yesterday. Yesterday, we discussed how India has the highest prevalence of child wasting in the world, and we spoke about the chronic problem of hunger and undernutrition in the country. So the findings of this research paper, combined with the findings of the Global Hunger Index report of 2020, paints an alarming picture with regard to nutrition in India. Next, on page number 12, we have a very interesting column in which the writer explains the impact of global warming and climate change on global food security. In this column, he is specifically examining the impact of rising CO2 levels and rising temperature on plant growth and plant productivity, that is agricultural productivity. Because at the end, agricultural productivity is directly linked to our food security. See, we already know that ever since the first industrial revolution began in the 1800s till now, the global temperature has nearly increased by 2 degrees Celsius, mainly because of the rampant burning of fossil fuels. The burning of fossil fuels around the world has released large quantities of greenhouse gases, including carbon dioxide, and as a result, CO2 levels in the atmosphere has increased from 280 parts per million to 400 parts per million. So this significant increase in CO2 levels directly contributes to global warming, because CO2 is a greenhouse gas which traps the sun's radiation and leads to increase in temperature of the atmosphere. It is also a known fact that this increase in CO2 levels has disrupted the carbon cycle, and as a result, this might have an impact on plant growth and agricultural productivity. Currently, there is sufficient scientific evidence available to indicate that global warming and climate change are directly contributing to the increasing melting of glaciers and the subsequent rise in sea levels. In fact, a recent study by National Geographic has shown that the glaciers in Uttarakhand might disappear by 2035. Despite such scientific evidence being available, it is highly unfortunate that leaders such as Donald Trump and Brazilian President Jair Bolsonaro dismiss climate change as just a conspiracy theory, and they are actively promoting industrial growth with complete disregard to the available scientific evidence. It is also a well-established fact that climate change and global warming will have a direct impact on our marine environment and as well as on our terrestrial environment. In the seas and the oceans, rising CO2 levels directly contributes to the acidification of the ocean, because carbon dioxide in the atmosphere dissolves with water to form carbonic acid. And this turns the seas and the oceans more acidic, which in turn causes enormous damage to marine life. Studies have shown that increasing oceanic acidification can weaken the shells and the skeleton of marine life, and it also destroys the coral reefs and the planktons, which play a critical role in the marine ecosystem. So such disruption in the marine environment will obviously affect the availability of seafood, and this could threaten food security around the world. On the terrestrial environment, it's very clear that rising CO2 levels directly contributes to global warming, because carbon dioxide is a major greenhouse gas. But however, its impact on plant growth and plant productivity is not entirely understood. A few available studies shows that rising CO2 levels is actually good for plant growth because it aids photosynthesis and the growth of plants. But however, studies have also shown that rising CO2 levels and rising temperature can restrict nitrogen absorption in plants, thereby having a negative impact on plant growth and productivity. Studies have also shown that rising CO2 levels and rising temperature will have a greater impact in the tropical areas and in the subtropical areas. A few recent studies conducted on Bermuda grass has shown that increased CO2 levels is actually beneficial for the growth of the grass, and according to these studies, increased CO2 levels has introduced greater heat tolerance in this variety of grass. So apparently, rising CO2 levels might have some benefits with regard to plant growth and productivity, but however, this correlation is not entirely understood. Of course, global warming and climate change will have an enormous and disastrous impact on plant growth and productivity, but apparently there happens to be some benefits as well. So in this context, the writer says that there is an urgent need for more scientific studies to be conducted to understand how plant behavior changes in the context of higher CO2 levels and higher temperatures. So the writer says that such studies will have to be conducted on legumes and grains, because these are the kind of plant crops that we consume. So if we have to understand the impact of global warming and climate change on food security, then these studies have to be conducted on legumes and grains to determine how these conditions and factors will affect human consumption and food security. Recently, the Hyderabad-based ICRISAT, or the International Crops Research Institute for the Semi-Arid Tropics, had conducted such a study on chana dal and kabuli chana. And this study has shown that in the presence of increased CO2 levels, these plants have shown increased growth in the root and the shoot, thereby resulting in increased height of the plant. The study has also shown that in chana dal and in kabuli chana, the root nodules have increased, which play host to the nitrogen-fixing bacteria. While these factors might be beneficial for plant growth and productivity, it also shows that increased CO2 levels can affect growth and productivity because it decreases the chlorophyll content, which causes the leaves to turn yellow, and it contributes to the aging of plants as well. So in this context, the writer makes a case for building upon the works of this year's Nobel laureates, Jennifer Doudna and Emmanuel Charpentier, whose invention of the CRISPR-Cas9 gene editing technology won them the Nobel Prize for Chemistry. The writer says that through further studies, we can understand how the genetic structure of each plant is playing a role in the presence of higher CO2 levels and higher temperature. And based on this understanding, the gene structure can be edited by using CRISPR-Cas9 technology to make the plants, especially the food plants, more resilient to rising CO2 levels and rising temperature, which is an outcome of global warming and climate change. The writer says that this is one way through which we can secure ourselves and insulate ourselves from the impact of global warming and climate change on food security. And he presents this as a solution through which we can mitigate the impact of climate change and global warming on food security. And this could probably help us to adapt to the impact of climate change. Now let's take up a column from page number 14, which helps us understand the role, functions, and the structure of the UN Human Rights Council. See, just a couple of days ago, we took up a practice question related to the UNHRC, through which we understood the composition of the Human Rights Council and how members are elected to the UNHRC. We had discussed that countries such as Pakistan, Uzbekistan, China, Nepal, Russia, Cuba, etc. have been elected to the UNHRC, despite these countries having a controversial track record with regard to promotion and protection of human rights in their respective countries. Previously, countries such as Saudi Arabia, Israel, etc. have also become members of the UNHRC, and this has always raised questions over the credibility of UNHRC. So in this context, let's understand the role, the structure, and the functions of the UNHRC in detail, and also talk about the problems facing the organization. See, the United Nations Human Rights Council is a UN body that has been established to promote and protect human rights around the world. It was established by the UN General Assembly in 2006 in order to replace the United Nations Commission on Human Rights, which was a predecessor organization to the UNHRC. See, the United Nations Commission on Human Rights had to be replaced because its functioning had become highly controversial and the organization was strongly criticized for allowing countries with poor human rights records to become members of the organization. So to replace this ineffective institution, the UNHRC was established by the UN General Assembly in 2006, and from then it has become a central structure in the global human rights architecture, and it has members drawn from the UN General Assembly. This institution is headquartered in Geneva, Switzerland, and it carries out two very important functions. One, the UNHRC has the powers to conduct a universal periodic review of all the 193 member states of the UN. And based on this review, the Council can pass non-binding resolutions through which action can be taken against countries with a poor human rights record. The second function of the UNHRC is to monitor and oversee expert investigation of alleged violation of human rights in specific countries. This function of the UNHRC is technically known as Special Procedures of the UNHRC. So through these two functions, the UNHRC has the powers to investigate allegations of breaches of human rights in several critical domains, including freedom of association and assembly, freedom of expression, freedom of belief and religious faith, women's rights, LGBT rights, rights of racial and ethnic minorities, political and democratic rights, etc. But however, the functioning and effectiveness of this crucial organization has always come into question because of the nature of its structure and composition. See, the UNHRC is made up of 47 member states who are elected for staggered 3-year terms. These elections are held every year because members are selected on a rotational basis. And the seats at the UNHRC are allocated on a regional basis in order to ensure equitable geographical representation. So the 47 seats are equitably divided between different regions of the world, such as Asia Pacific, Europe, Africa, North America, South America, etc. So this allows countries from a specific region to contest the elections. But however, the problem of this structure and composition is that it has allowed several countries with a questionable human rights track record to get elected as members of the UNHRC. So this is basically a repeat of the predecessor organization of the UNHRC. See, in one way, the UNHRC is a significant improvement over its previous organization, and it is considered to be more equitable and representative as compared to many other multilateral organizations. Because of the UNHRC, all members get a chance to get elected because of the rotational elections that are held. Then more importantly, during elections and as well as during voting on resolutions, each state enjoys just one vote. So this provides for a representative mechanism without any special privileges to any country, which is otherwise seen in other institutions such as the UN Security Council and other Western-dominated institutions such as the World Bank and the IMF. So in one way, the UNHRC is more fair, equitable and representative as compared to other multilateral institutions. But there exists a major problem with regard to its structure and composition. So the repeated election of countries with poor human rights track record and the frequent misuse of the UNHRC platform on geopolitical grounds has raised questions over the credibility of the organization. Now let's take up the practice questions for today. Which of the following statements are correct? Mohammedan Anglo-Oriental College was founded in 1875 by Sir Syed Ahmed Khan. Mohammedan Anglo-Oriental College later became the Aligarh Muslim University in 1920. Both the statements are correct. Option C is the right answer. This question has been asked because we have an article on page number 5 that refers to Sir Syed Day that marks the anniversary of the Aligarh Muslim University, which was established by Sir Syed Ahmed Khan. Now let's take up the next question. Which of the following statements are correct? The Rishikulya River originates in the Western Ghats Range and flows through Maharashtra. It drains into the Arabian Sea. Both the statements are incorrect, so option D is the right answer. Because see, the Rishikulya River is an important river in the state of Odisha, not Maharashtra. And it takes birth in the Eastern Ghats, not the Western Ghats. So obviously, the Rishikulya River drains into the Bay of Bengal and not the Arabian Sea. Please look at this map. This is where the Rishikulya River flows in the state of Odisha. It drains into the Bay of Bengal. And the mouth of the Rishikulya River is very important from an ecological point of view, because it happens to be one of the mass nesting sites for the olive ridley turtles. This question on the Rishikulya River has been asked because according to this article on page number 5, the villages that are present at the mouth of the Rishikulya River were facing a massive challenge. The mouth of the river had been blocked, and as a result, it was causing flooding in the nearby villages, and it was also affecting the fishing community because they were not able to take their boats out into the sea. So to deal with this problem, the villagers have taken up an initiative on their own, and they have created an artificial opening which has allowed the Rishikulya River to freely flow into the Bay of Bengal by bypassing the natural opening which had been choked. Now let's take up the next question. Which institution is entrusted with the task of monitoring the flood situation in the country and issuing flood forecasts? The correct answer is option C, the Central Water Commission. This question has been asked because according to this article on page number 6, the flood situation in Telangana and Andhra Pradesh is being monitored by the Central Water Commission and it has been issuing flood forecasts. Now let's take up the next question. The controversial Yasukuni War Shrine is located in which country? The correct answer is option B, Japan. This question has been asked because according to this article on page number 10, Japanese Prime Minister Yoshihide Suga has paid a visit to the controversial Yasukuni War Shrine. This shrine is highly controversial because a number of countries around the world see the Yasukuni War Shrine as a symbolic representation of Japan's imperialism and militarism and its war crimes committed, especially during the Second World War. See, this war shrine is located in Tokyo and it has been set up to commemorate all the soldiers of Japan who have lost their lives in several wars fought between the 1800s all the way up to the 1950s. This obviously includes the Second World War as well. At this shrine, the names and the details of the soldiers who have lost their lives has been inscribed, and controversially, it also includes thousands of war criminals as well. These are convicted war criminals who have been held guilty of being involved in the commission of war crimes. So that's the reason why any visit by Japanese leaders to this war shrine attracts a major controversy. And interestingly, the Yasukuni War Shrine also has an Indian connection. Popular Indian jurist and judge Radha Binod Pal was one of the members of the United Nations International Law Commission, and as a result, he was appointed as one of the judges of the International Military Tribunal for the Far East, which was established after the Second World War, to conduct the Tokyo trials, in which Japanese soldiers, military officers and leaders were held guilty of war crimes that were committed during the Second World War. In fact, the Tokyo trials has inspired a Netflix show as well by the same name, in which Indian actor Irfan Khan portrays the role of Radha Binod Pal. This Indian judge happens to be a very important historical figure because as a part of the tribunal, he was the only judge who provided a dissenting judgment. See, a majority of the judges who were a part of the tribunal, they were from Western countries and they were naturally biased against Japan, which was one of the Axis powers. Because the Second World War was clearly won by the Allied powers of the West and they were selectively targeting those countries which were part of the Axis bloc. So during the Tokyo trials, all the judges except for Radha Binod Pal, they held the accused Japanese soldiers guilty of war crimes, and Radha Binod Pal was the only judge who provided a dissenting judgment. In his judgment, Radha Binod Pal had argued that no such crimes were listed under international law when Japan went to war, and hence such retrospective application of law is not valid. And according to him, this approach of the Western countries went against every accepted legal procedure. So this stand of Radha Binod Pal and his dissenting judgment in favor of Japan made him a very popular figure in Japan. And as a result, a dedicated monument has been set up for Radha Binod Pal at two important war shrines of Japan, that is the Yasukuni Shrine and another shrine at Kyoto. But however, we need to remember that Radha Binod Pal never supported the atrocities that were committed by Imperial Japan during the Second World War. He was merely making a case for fair treatment because Western countries, that is the Allied powers, they were singling out Japan, while all the major powers of that time were equally guilty of committing grave crimes and atrocities as a result of their imperialist lust. But however, this stand of Radha Vinod Pal made him very popular in Japan, and he continues to remain very relevant in Japan's politics even today. In fact, in 2007, when then Japanese Prime Minister Shinzo Abe visited India, he paid a tribute to Radha Vinod Pal, and he even visited his family in Kolkata. In 1966, Radha Vinod Pal was awarded Japan's highest honors, and this represents a historical cultural connection as well between India and Japan. Now let's take up the next question. Which of the following statements are correct? The Nobel Prize for Economics is officially known as the Sverges Riksbank Prize in Economic Sciences in memory of Alfred Nobel. In 2020, it has been awarded for improvements to auction theory and inventions of new auction formats. Both the statements are correct, so option C is the right answer. This question has been asked because we have a column on page number 13 that pays tribute to this year's Nobel laureates for economics and explains what is the auction theory. See, auction theory is basically a branch of economics that deals with the process of auctions. Auctions are the preferred route through which most governments around the world allocate scarce resources. And American economists Robert Wilson and Paul Milgrom have developed a scientific economic theory known as the auction theory in order to make the process more effective and scientific. Now let's take up a practice question from the 2016 prelims paper. Consider the following statements. The minimum age prescribed for any person to be a member of panchayat is 25 years. This statement is incorrect because the minimum age for panchayat elections is 21 years. The second statement says that a panchayat reconstituted after premature dissolution continues only for the remainder period. This statement is correct. So option B is the right answer. Finally, let's take up a couple of mains practice questions. The first question, examine India's role in the liberation of Bangladesh war. The second question, illustrate how global warming might affect food security. Kindly write an answer to these questions and post your answers in the comment section below. So this concludes our discussion for the day. Thanks for watching.